All right, we are right here in the back of the Biddle Johnson household. This is where we ended filming for Slayer 2. And did a few other scenes back here.
I remember right before you came back, or right when you started coming back around in 05, I stopped by here one day after I picked Brittany up from school. Me and Justin were standing right over in that area talking about like plans for maybe a movie we were going to make.
Yeah.
And then just a month later, we were filming Slayer 2 right here on this property. Looks a lot different.
One of my most favorite scenes we ever saw was right here, where we had the killer get burnt, lift the dummy up.
In Slayer 2, we put the dummy right. We don't know the exact area, but it was somewhere here, in this area here.
Burn in hell, bitch!
In hell.
The killer was here and he got burned alive. Also, let's stay focused on Slayer 2 at the moment. Up there is where the killer
is, behind that tree right there.
Where
Biddle was riding the four-wheeler around, and then you were dressed up as AJ Goff behind that tree right there.
Yeah, Biddle was playing a character named Ali, the motorcycle guy. He was driding his four-wheeler around, and when he got through that area there, AJ Borden, which was me, popped out behind that tree there. Biddle came back.
Where's the tree at that
that's what I was about
that
to look
he
for.
Hit? Must have been rude where with the one where he.
Oh yeah, well here's the. Biddle did another circle around, and when Biddle got to the area again, I popped out at him, and I started. Yeah. I chased Biddle all the way down this hill here. Down that hill, so the tree would have had to have been
right here.
Yeah, I mean Biddle hit the tree shoulder first and kind of knocked himself out, and then AJ Borden slashed his throat.
Yep, so I guess it was right here, and it's been removed since.
Yeah, the tree is gone. We'll have to ask Justin about the tree when we see him. Justin's not here, but he's given us permission to be here. Over here, all this stuff's been added. Over there's where the trampoline used to sit. The trampoline was where the Kelly character was jumping around on.
Yeah.
In Slayer 2. Also, me and Justin and Biddle used to wrestle on the trampoline when we was back in high school.
Yeah.
And that all this has been added. None of this stuff was here during Slayer 2. We've not been on this property since 2006, when we did the Slayer 6 movie, or Slayer 4.
Yeah.
Now let's get to Slayer 3. In this area, Biddle was playing a character named Scotto, the hockey player, and AJ Borden lured.
Yep.
Scotto out in this area, and then
I popped up from the leaves right here, and then
Sean Baxter rose. Actually, you were buried in hay.
Well, whatever it was.
And the
funny thing about that is like I was laying there for so long, and it was really cold that night.
Oh yeah,
and I ended up getting sick.
Yeah.
And so I was sick in the later scenes of Slayer 3 because of laying there.
And let's go to this other part of the area. This is where you'd see the Austin Birmingham character. One more thing we want to add during that Slayer 3 scene. Scotto and the AJ Borden character went straight through this area here. Now that's virtually, that would be impossible now because that pathway is no longer there.
Climb over this stuff.
I remember this creek was always here, but it seemed like there was some kind of.
There's an easier path.
Yeah, there's an easier path to get through this area. That was 8 years ago. We'll get one quick shot, or one last shot here of the area where AJ Borden killed Ali. Slayer 2 Hollow Ground. Okay, this is the garage. A lot of epic stuff happened in there, like Austin Birmingham taking on Sean Baxter.
Yeah, I remember it was late night. Justin was off the road. We had the recorder set on the bottom. They later asked Justin what was going on, like why there was a fight in his driveway for it.
Also, this. Also, this is where Justin was playing a character named Hank something, and he sent me and you on errands to do on the original Slayer 4.
Oh yeah, he opened up the door.
Also, he chased.
Who the hell are you two stupid sons of bitches?
I'm trying to help me this time, man.
Also, he chased you out with the weed eater.
Yeah.
Chased you out with the weed eater.
Yeah.
This is where the weed eater scene happened at. Oh, and also in this area, me and you were talking to Austin, telling him about his upcoming wrestling training.
Yeah, and he just did this dick line saying, don't move.
Yeah, a lot of Slayer 2 scenes were filmed right here in this area. This is also Justin pulled up on his four-wheeler right here in this area. And when they first moved in here for like the first year or so, the trampoline was always in that area. So like me, Justin, and Biddle and Jake Herb would always put on wrestling matches for everybody driving by. Those were some fun times. Also, the only time I ever got to wrestle Jake Herb in any kind of wrestling match. Okay, this is a building that, if you've been in the Seymour area for the last 20 years, you know what this building was. This was formerly the Seymour Video Store.
Yeah, it was called the Video Barn.
The Video Barn, yeah.
And I've always called the Cat Video Store because they're always cat.
Yeah, nowadays that we call it the Cat Video Store, there was a lady named June that worked here. She was the owner of it, and her husband, Howard.
We actually just spoke to her at the restaurant next door.
Yeah, we actually just saw June at the barbecue place next door. That's where the counter would have been. And you used to take those. Hey, all the movies were like never in order.
Yeah. Like, I saw the only video is here was a wrestling video. But all wrestling matches from Naughty Dog. And a few horror movies.
Also, June ordered me Nightmare on Elm Street 2, 3, 4, and 5. That's what. Because you couldn't find those movies back. You couldn't find them in stores back then.
Yeah.
This is a sign that it's still the test of time. It's still here.
You're out here in the building here.
I never went to Putt-Putt Golfing Games.
I used to go there all the time. I was one of the last customers there. I had a birthday party here.
Oh, when did this place shut down?
Gosh. It was in 96, 97.
Dang, this is a historic.
Maybe 96.
There's not been another business here since.
Been sitting there. Still see
the. Oh, the sign's still there. That's amazing. Okay, this is a historic parking lot. If you were around here in the 90s, this was Lowe's. This, like you just said, this is the summer between second and third grade. This is the only place where we saw each other at. This would have been Lowe's.
And right next door is one of the last places that was there here for the night that just went out of business.
The Radio Shack just shut down last week and moved across the street. I don't remember what some of these stores were.
I don't remember what these stores were. We've been going to a place up here where one of my first video places.
That was Revco. I went there all the time with my grandparents. This would have been Winn-Dixie. It's completely different.
That place right ahead of us where it says, for at least that was the best, one of the best video stores ever.
And if that was the video store of the 90s.
One of my favorite ones. And then Little Caesars has been there for a while. And then.
And of course, Pizza Hut's always been there.
Yeah.
Well, here we are. This is 2013, and this is my former bedroom. A room I had for over 10 years. February of 2002, and I moved out of this room in February of 2013. So I had it for an exact 11 years. This is, it's in shambles now, because it's about to become a
hospital bathroom.
Yeah. And this is the old, gosh.
Old tiny bedroom.
Tiny bedroom also is the laboratory for Slayer 4. We used to have all the chemicals and stuff laid out here.
Yeah, this wall was just added to me. You used to just walk like straight in.
Yeah.
And there was like right here. That's where me and Amanda had our breakup scene.
Okay, whatever. We're broken up. What?
There's nothing that remains in this room that was mine except this Nightmare on Elm Street poster. Me and Nick bought this poster at a store at Easttown Mall on New Year's Eve of 2003. I came straight home, hung it up, and it's never been taken down ever. Because the way it was taped up, if I take it down, it's going to rip it. So that poster has been standing for almost 10 years. Oh yeah, and one more thing. The silly string, that's from Halloween of 2004. We got in a big silly string fight, and Justin just started shooting it all over the place, and that's been there for 9 years. Gosh.
Yeah, think of all the people that have walked into this room, and
all the
wrestling matches, and everybody, like the wrestling people, the friends, the girlfriends.
I've had probably over 20 or 30 girls come in this room. Half the wrestlers we've known have stepped foot in here. All of our high school friends. I'd say if you made a list, maybe 200 or more people have stepped foot in this room. We've had some of the funnest times of our lives, especially during our high school days, was in this room right here. This is what we called the party room. And at the first ever Halloween party in 2002, I remember Nick had a party going on here with the PlayStation. We had Nick and Cleveland and Cleveland's friends, and they were playing PlayStation 1, and then Patrick was over here looking at porno, and then me, Justin, Haji, and Carrie are in here doing a wrestling match. Okay, now after that football game where you made your big return, later that night, me, you, and Justin went to the parking lot. We went to Wendy's to get food, and we went to this parking lot right down here where we were about to go. And we were catching up on things, and
I remember sitting in the parking lot for forever that night. We just caught up because I hadn't been around in a year and a half to 2 years at that point.
Yeah, and then that began you started coming around, then we started going and seeing movies every week. We went and saw The Fog, Saw 2, and then
it was just started hammering out details for a movie project that we were wanting to start on.
Then we just wanted to start a movie project, and then we didn't know exactly what we were going to do it on. Didn't even know what the name of it was going to be, or what the killer's name was going to be. We just one Saturday in October and started filming.
Just filming random scenes.
On that Friday, Anthony Fletcher and Christian, everybody came over and we all started talking about the movie. And then once we got to Slayer 3, we filmed, there's some location scenes down here where we filmed at.
Sitting on hold ground for us right here. We're in this spot in 2005 on New Year's Eve. I was sitting here with some crystals picking myself up.
Okay, so this is where we shot the Slayer 3 scene at right here. This is the Jamaican pulled up right here in the eclipse, rolled the window down, and threw the bag of crystals at you.
Yeah, the bag of crystals sitting on that bench right there while I was at the machine. He stole it. He came around and he threw the bag of crystals and knocked me out of it right here in this location right here.
Yeah, you were sitting right there, and then me and Sarah Cusick came. Yeah, we came from this way here.
Y'all came from that way.
Came from that way because we went to the shopping. Yep, right here, the hollow ground of Slayer 3 got served with a Jamaican. Okay, this is where we shot Slayer 3 at also. This is where Christian came out as the Jeremy Pipps character. And those. Also, I remember one time me, you, and Christian went there to eat, and there was a broken salt shaker that I got blamed for. And Ben told me he was going to kick us out of here if we didn't stop breaking salt shakers.
So Christian actually broke one of the salt shakers.
It was actually Christian that did it, and I got framed for it. So we had to...
We sold one of them. We gave it to Justin to play as the Jamaican. He came out... I was sitting around here as the character Ash Bentley. And Justin came with the clip one again and broke the salt shaker right there.
Shook the salt shaker, then went on, and it all happened right here. Also, this is where we dressed, on the other side of the building here, we dressed up in Halloween costumes with the clown and Michael Myers.
Yeah, in October we got free drinks for that. We went to the window.
Yep.
At the exterior of the nightclub.
Oh, well, that was actually, that whole scene in Slayer 4 was based off of, I guess that Jeremy Pipps guy used to work at Wendy's, and he would always threaten to fight us and want us to come over there and fight him. So we basically recreated a whole scene with me as him and me trying to fight Extreme and Chad there.
Hey, you guys get back here if you all want to fight. Come over here.
Let's fight.
Come right over here.
Let's fight.
Come over here. Come over here.
You're a dumbass.
And they started coming at me, so that pretty much came from there. But that was an exciting role to play because we all had fun with that guy, that Jeremy Pipps guy. He was pretty crazy.
That was Amanda Seller's boyfriend.
Yeah, and he apparently treated her really bad and everything. I remember one time I parked my car at Wendy's. We went to go do something.
Oh God, what a nut that was.
And then I came back and my taillight looked like it had been like moved or something or like. Something like that. It turns out that I ended up doing it myself. But I blame it on Jeremy Pipps because I had more hatred for that kid than I ever had for Haji.
I guess what we did with you at the lock, you did the Jeremy Fist with your headlight.
Yeah, but it wasn't really. I forgot about it in my head. I really thought he did that for a time period. So I was like getting ready to fight him. I was wanting to bang on the Wendy's doors and everything, drag him out of there. So I ended up trying to cool down the Kroger parking lot, and I grabbed a buggy, and I tossed the buggy across the Kroger parking lot, and Jeremy came out there, and he was his hands like this, and said, "Come back here if y'all want to fight."
Yeah, but he had this big 6'4", big bulked up guy standing right in front of him.
And he was like in the bushes or something.
Yeah, in the bush. So if we'd have went down there and tried to get anywhere close to him, the guy was gonna pound us.
Yeah. Yeah, but so therefore we had a scene where we had Christian dressed up like Jeremy, and we reenacted that pretty much almost that entire scene in a goofier kind of way.
Doing here?
Hey, we want to go in there.
You guys ain't going in there. You guys can't come here and cause all this trouble.
Hey.
I stole your job because you was dumping grease in the parking lot. You guys ain't staying here.
Shut up, Jeremy.
You're a dumbass.
No.
You're a dork, Jeremy.
No.
I told you I can't.
You gotta get back here. You guys get back here right now.
Hey, you wanna fight?
Well, we'll fight. Get back here if y'all wanna fight.
We kind of reenacted that. The exterior of the nightclub scene, we're behind some of the doctor's office buildings here off Chapman Highway. This is where we shot the outside.
You was dressed up as Sean Baxter and you was taking on the Jenny, played by Sarah Cusick. I was filming it right about from this
Slayer
angle here.
3. And funny thing about that scene is that she really like beat the crap out of me with that plastic.
Whatever the other thing was.
She literally ran my head into this curb right here.
Oh. This is also where the Jamaican tried to power bomb.
Oh yeah, power bomb Sean Baxter. And he had the closest parked here, and then AJ Borden killed the Jamaican in the back of the.
Yep, and then. Like you said, this was the exterior of the nightclub. Sarah Cusick and the killer ran this way, but that actually wasn't the nightclub. The nightclub was shot in the basement of your house.
My old house.
This is it right here. This is the parking lot. This is the nightclub parking lot from Slayer 3, Goth Served. Revisited. First time we've been here in 8 years. And this is over here behind Food City, inside the Food City building where me as Brett and you as Ash race the buggies down here. Everybody still.
You end up crashing.
Yep. Okay, the documentary continues, and now we are at Bowards Field here in Seymour, and this, I can't help but think about 1998 when I'm here. This is when Biddle was, Justin's brother, Nick Biddle, was playing softball down here. Eddie was the coach. So we come down here at least 3 or 4 times a week. Everything still looks the same. First off, we'll start here. This is the batting cage. Me, Justin, and Biddle and some of Biddle's friends got here and kind of wrestled around. I think they were having a birthday party down here that day. It was on a Saturday. And I'm pretty sure this net, this guy would probably be the same net that was here then. That door was even there, or this little thing here was even there in 98. Amazing. Same exact spot.
Better days.
Same exact spot that thing's not been moved.
It's the exact same spot?
Yeah.
It's definitely seen better days. What is the thing, like a batting cage thing?
Yeah, I think so. Also in 98, we come down here during the week. There was a girl I had a crush on named Ashley Stewart. So me and Justin would follow her all around the, all over the area. Like we were kind of stalkers back then. And she would always be, we'd always see her right here in this area. So we'd always we'd creep around this area. There was also a Sunday we had to come down here. This is my most memorable Bowards Field story. Because me and Justin didn't eat all morning, and we thought we were going to come down here and get some food at the concession stand. But we got down here on that Sunday at noon, and Biddle had games all day long, and the concession stand wasn't even open. So we had to stay down here all day long, no food. We kept thinking about running across the highway to Daniel's Bar and Grill. But we had no money. And then the payoff to that day, at the end of the day, Phyllis actually made us a steak that night. It was a good dinner and made up for us staying down here all day starving to death. This is the concession stand right here where Justin's mom Phyllis worked at quite a bit. Justin even worked this concession stand a lot.
Justin worked this stand?
Yeah, during the weekend. Nick
served beans and cornbread.
And one night, me and Nick came down here during the week and Nick kept knocking on this door and running. Making Justin mad.
Don't move.
These bleachers, same bleachers that were here in 98, probably all through the 90s.
Dugout's the same, looks like.
This area here, we used to have a lot of little, after all Bill's games, we'd come over here and eat cake and stuff. And this is brought kind of the hangout at the end of the night.
Yeah, there's not much this
now,
changed much.
Wait a minute, there is one thing missing.
Is that thing moved? Play area over there?
Well, you just remind me. Speaking of play area, this used to be a little playground area right here. There was swings.
Right here?
Yeah, there was swings and a slide. And we would all, yeah. Yeah, they took, Well, because that's one thing that's changed. They've took out the little playground. It was swings and a slide that we'd always would get on.
Look, they moved the area to.
That wasn't there back then.
That's a new play area then.
And then, let's see here. This is the field right here where Biddle always played on. And Eddie would always be out here coaching. Yeah, so the whole spring of 98 we were down here all the time. This all still looks the same. Oh yeah, and Phyllis always, Justin, remember this, Phyllis always used to be up there. So like when we had to go ask Phyllis something.
Well, what was she doing up there?
I don't know, I just remember Justin always had to go up there and ask her stuff. She was up there. This is the area we'd see a lot of our school friends would be down here during the night. Seems like something's been taken out, because I don't remember this big empty area here. And then the football, looks like a little football field over there.
Oh yeah. Okay, goal post. The coach walk.
Also remember one weekend day we'd be Eddie and everybody was out here and Justin was playing ball with, remember Ryan and Con King? They were always out here on this field right here.
All right, this is the location of where it used to be Video Ventures, which turned into Video Plus. Now it's Walgreens.
It used to be a little blue video store.
And Jay Bantico's mom used to work there.
Okay, now we are revisiting Fagley Road. This is where we saw the famous Fagley Road ghost.
This area right here used to be all woods in 2005. You'd see nothing but trees right here.
It's been 8 years since this place has been on camera. Always wanted to film a movie down here, but we never got around. This is amazing. This used to be all wooded area, and look at all the animals over there. Dang.
Finding the cat, we found
like a lady in white.
A lady in white over here in this area. On a dock over there.
Yep. It was that December day in 2005.
He actually went out to Fagley Road to follow this cat that was supposed to lead us to a abandoned haunted house. But we actually, in turn, found a ghost off to the right standing on a dock. And we all were actually pretty terrified. It was pretty terrifying. So we caught all that on camera. We got it all. Nobody believed us until we showed them the footage. But it's all there. It's pretty scary stuff.
Here's the trailer.
Where? There it is.
See, that's like a swamp or something over there.
With what?
I think it's that.
I see. I got it on camera. I don't know, man.
That's where the cat was sitting up on that big rug.
Somebody's watching us.
Who is that?
Like someone in a mask or something.
I am. What does it look like?
There's that trailer we used to
like
about.
A lady in like a prison that. Suit or something.
Prison suit.
That's freaky looking.
That trailer?
Over there is more concerning than the.
Yeah.
She goes.
Is that
she looking at us? The chimney is. Let's get out of here.
I don't see the cat, do you?
No. I'm more concerned about that lady over there.
Me too. It was that December day in 2005. And I was trying to find the cat. Christians, I'm more concerned about that lady over there.
Yep.
Now this is where the
house. There used to be a chimney right there. You can see on our clip here. I'm gonna put in. There's a chimney right there.
Is the chimney still there? The
chimney is not there.
The chimney's even gone now.
Yeah, chimney.
Remember, I got stuck in the driveway.
There used to be a trailer up here also. Like a camper.
And there was always that big rock that the cat would sit on.
Yep, that's all gone too. Lady. It looks like that dock is even gone now.
Well,
in the middle of it.
Is that where she was? Well, yeah, the thing she was standing on, I believe, is gone. Unless that was it right there.
It could have moved. It was on the same location as it was.
I always wanted to film a movie down there too. Look how green the water is.
Moved.
Oh yeah, she, the lady was right there. The yeah. Ghost.
Yep.
Alright, well, cameras have not been rolling here since 2007. We are at the Wayland Inn in Seymour.
Yep. And as we were just looking, there's even more destruction of the house. That...
Wow.
Look at the whole side of the stairs was taken out. Crazy. You see the blanket up there.
That's creepy looking.
We had that blanket like flipped over the...
Yeah, but it was, yeah.
The stairway last time we were in there.
Let's get a shot here of this house. First time I went to this house was in 2005, and that's what we're covering right now. Yeah. Wow, where do
I first came here in March of 2005. We were doing a documentary of old houses. And can you get... Do you have enough light in here? We're only going to be here for a short time.
Yeah, we can get...
Oh, well, that was also an exciting time. So we were all walking through the house, and it was pretty late at night. It was pitch black dark. We had a couple of flashlights. She couldn't see anything. She didn't have a flashlight. So we were walking through the house, and it was me, Chris, Chad, and Justin, and Sarah. Minus Justin, and so we were walking through the house, and then all of a sudden Chad disappeared, and nobody really noticed. But later on, we got back downstairs, and all of a sudden a light started showing up, and we didn't know what it was, and we knew what it was, but Sarah didn't know what it was, so she got pretty terrified, but she didn't want to run because she didn't want the ghost to chase her, but Chad started cracking up eventually, so she realized who it was. But that was a pretty fun time.
Oh my God! No, you can't leave, because if we walk away, it's gonna chase us.
What is this?
What?
I don't know. It doesn't even have look at his hands.
Oh God!
Where's his face?
I told you there's stuff in this house.
Oh my God! Chad, you asshole! Oh my God, he did that! Oh my God! That scared the crap out of me! Oh my God, that scared the crap out of me!
He started laughing!
You can see more.
The first time I came here was...
I can see more here now.
November 2005 is the first time I came here, and we filmed Slayer 2 here. We made this the killer's house. This was the house of Sean Baxter.
In one of the upstairs bedrooms, we had him peering out through the window. We will edit that scene in here in a little while.
Here's some more.
Those doors are always closed back.
Here's some more. Another shot here of the house. This even looks so much different than just from 2005. There used to be clothes hanging up here. This is where we put the arm in Slayer 5. And we had blood dripping down. There's the blood still there. Man, we're going to tell you some stories that are on in this documentary of... Scared Sarah Cusick, times we scared you.
Nah, myself. It's so weird being here in the day.
No, now we got some lighting here. Yeah, we ain't been here in the daylight. And...
There's where we put Paul Seguna, your clothes, which was actually Paul Seguna's.
That was the body we made as Paul Seguna in the Slayer 6 movie. was probably our best lit room here. This is where we put Sean Baxter at to stand.
This is also a place where I had my cell phone in my hand one night, and I would,
Oh yeah, that.
Do you want to tell that story? But we were up here in the room
when that happened. Yeah, for the fact that we scared you was something I'm proud of, because that took a lot of work. Because Christian and Sarah knew what we were going to do, and Justin had to go along with it, and Justin acted like he was going to work. So then we brought you here, and then Justin showed up a few minutes later because Christian called him. So then we get you up in this room here, and then we start hearing the banging.
Yeah.
Banging downstairs.
I had no idea it was just downstairs until I saw his boots. I was like,
oh, you was about
that's
to
just. I was about to jump out the window.
You had your cell phone out, and then we came over here. And then you looked down.
And that's all. I saw Justin's boot down there. But I remember when the first time I came here, there used to be like a thing with like kids' clothes right here, like jackets and stuff, old-timey clothes. In this room, there was a baby crib, which...
Well, the baby crib's long gone.
Yeah,
Sean Baxter killed Ben Rouse.
Yeah, with the chainsaw. Ben, yeah, we had
Oh, God.
The crib was right here, and then I remember.
We used the crib in Slayer 5.
Yes, yeah, so Slayer 5 in.
Here's the outside. We've never shot this area of the house or of the property here. Somebody could really do a real good horror movie here. Kind of like,
yeah. You know, unfortunately, this place has not been restored, which I wish somebody would have actually restored this place. It's a sad thing, the shape it's in over the years. Like, whenever we first came here in 05, it was actually in much better shape. Remember, you and some friends actually knocked out all the glass in here.
Yeah, not in this room. It was more in the downstairs room.
Yeah, back in the day, there was actually, you can still see the windows in 05.
There's also...
Now there's no glass at all.
There's also a story that floats around Seymour that a lady was shot here.
Yeah, downstairs. The first time I came in, there was all the bloody curtains, but they're gone.
1970, a lady was shot through the window, and that was the last time this house was lived in. This house has been empty now for 44 years. Wow, that's hard to believe. And the house was built in 1862 by some guy named Whalen, and they used it later on as a bed and breakfast.
Used the bed and breakfast as a hospital for Civil War soldiers.
And we did, like I said, we scared Sarah Cusick here. We'll talk about that later on. We've also taken probably about 200 people or more we've taken in this house over the last 8 years.
Yeah.
Just last September, we took probably 20 or 30 in one weekend. That's probably what we're most known for around this town, bringing people to the haunted house. Plus all the ghost stories we've had here, the banging on the wall that night, the voices.
We heard banging on the wall right here, and then we darted out into my car, and we had weeds in my car and everything.
And last time we were here, this blanket just randomly appeared.
Yeah, it was like literally just draped over the stairway by itself. That is no, it's hard. I know it's probably think I'm delusional, but that really did happen.
I mean, you were in the same spot about almost 6 years ago today, where the Casey Stout was standing here as the killer.
Yeah. And he chased and we saw him in this room, and then we walked and came down the steps. We'll put that in here.
All right, and this house, a major part of 2005. It's become a major part of our lives. And here's Creekside Plantations. This is where me and Justin and Haji would come in here sometimes during the week to golf, and we'd make fools of ourselves because there'd always be like old rich people down here. And we suck. Okay, here now we're down at the driving range. This is a place we started going to in 2005. after high school, we needed some hobbies. So me, Justin, and Haji would come down here on Friday and Saturdays and hit some balls. And then in 2005. And then in 2005, we used this area for Slayer 3.
Yeah, we were right here in this area here, and I remember I was the worst one out of the group, and I was almost hit the dirt. You told me I need to get back to wrestling.
Yeah, 2000.
Yeah,
phone's
ringing.
Haji Justin was down here at least once or twice a week.
Man, we had business to have for having Jamaican out there in the middle of the field throwing balls at us.
Yeah.
This is our last location in this documentary here. We are here at Seymour First Baptist and we're at the track. All right, there's not much to say here. Except for the fact that this has been one of the safe haven places that we've came to clear our heads, to rid ourselves of stressful situations. I'd also come here to run, get in shape. I used this quite a bit whenever I was training for the police academy back in 2008. I'm using it a lot more now since I'm training to go into the Navy and making sure I'm in shape. It's one lap around this thing is about... just under a mile, so that's what I've been doing here a lot, and this has been a place where we could just come and forget about the worries. It's a great place, and most Saturdays there's normally soccer games or lacrosse games or football games or something kind of activity going on here with there's a lot of kids and people around. So right now it's kind of dead, but this has been a pretty good place. April, I'm gonna try to squeeze that in. Yeah, okay. We were celebrating. I'm not sure what. Were you pissed off that she wouldn't date you or something? So we went and celebrate. We broke up with you or something. We ended up still straight in the car.
Oh yeah, I liked her and she seemed to like me, but it was just a whole couldn't really get past a certain. It's like she didn't. So I just had enough of it, and
so me, you, and Justin loaded up in the car, and we silly strained. We went through the Food City parking lot. We silly strained her car, and then we came back here. We started talking about it, and bragging about it, and then she called you, and she said, "My bro's down here. He's gonna kick your old ass or something."
No. Actually, she called and said she was being all nice, told me to come up there. She didn't say nothing about her brother. She called and said she might have told me about the brother first, but then she called back and said, "Come up here, I want to see you," and all this. And part of it, first of all, I didn't think her brother was really going to do anything. And two, I was kind of curious to hear what she had to say. So we went in the car, we got in the car, and went back up there. And that's when we walked into the trap.
And so the idiots we were, I was driving, so we drove by, and then me and my smart-ass attitude, we looked up, and I honked at him.
Like, she was out in the parking lot with Crystal Moore, Daniel's girlfriend.
And then we drove on.
Oh, and there came the big truck.
And then the truck came, right behind
like
me.
Like a big monster
truck. I thought I could make a turn around the parking lot and turn around back around. But what happened, I turned to a small parking lot, and he blocked us in.
Yeah.
So we were stuck in this parking lot. There's no way out. So he came up to my window. He's like, "Come on out of here. I want to talk to you for a minute." So we all refused to get out. And he started talking about how heads were going to roll and how he was tired.
He was sleeping and got woke up. He's like, "I got woke up for this shit. He's like, I'm going to crack some skulls."
Crack some skulls and heads were going to roll. And then
he said we peeled the paint off her car.
Oh, yeah.
Because the silly string froze on her car.
I don't even think he saw Justin in the back seat. Maybe he's just talking to us, but I know after he left, Justin said that he would have kicked his ass if he tried anything.
Yeah.
So, who knows if that would have happened or not. But
also, here's a good question: had you have not pulled in that parking lot and just kept going straight, I wonder how far he would have chased us, because he was right up on the car,
Yeah. Okay. He could have just gotten more and more pissed off as he had.
Yeah, that's why
the farther he had to have chased it. So maybe it all worked out for the better.
Rose.
Oh yeah, I remember I really liked Amanda, so I went to a gas station, and then I was like, I'm gonna buy her a rose and leave it on her doorstep. So I went to the gas station. I just grabbed the first rose I found, and I bought it. And we got back in Justin and the Cliffs, and we headed to Amanda's. Halfway to Amanda's, like Justin's like, look at this thing, and he looked at it, and he started dying laughing, I think, and he's like, dude, this is plastic.
Oh, that's funny. Oh, that was.
So I remember I was like, I'm not gonna go anywhere else and buy something else. I think I paid like.
Yeah, it's my idea for you to just go do it anyway for comedy. Yeah. Just go give it to her.
I think I paid $5 for that rose anyway, so I didn't like spend any more money. So I left on our doorstep and I got the hell out of there, and somebody texted her and told her to check and told her for me, and then Amanda ended up thinking it was kind of sweet, and she eventually invited me to go with her parents to some work party somewhere. We kind of mentioned this little heated thing that me and Christian got into at the time.
Now this is ugly. This is I remember him putting your computer in the White Star parking lot on a rainy day.
Yeah, I remember, now we're older and we understand that slavery movies were kind of stupid and weren't scary. They were fun to do, but they weren't like scary masterpieces like we thought. Christian at that time was actually trying to tell us the truth.
I think we thought, when we were on the trampoline wrestling, we thought those were epic matches, just like we thought our Slayer movies were horror masterpieces.
Horror masterpieces, and Christian was trying to tell us the truth that they were,
they weren't that scary, they had bad effects.
They weren't that good, and then we took offense to it because of all the hard work we had to pour into. We took super offense to it, so I was just getting pissed off at Christian, and part of me, I was kind of jealous because he started hanging out with him and Justin more, so I was kind of mad. I remember one time y'all made this little music video while I was at work.
Oh, yeah, homies, we had the mask on.
And then for some reason, I just got more and more pissed off at Christian.
Because he was kind of taking over.
And since I was getting mad at him, he was getting mad at me. So eventually, the first time we tried to shoot the whaling in scene in Slayer 2, it was rainy, so we had to reshoot it. But the first time Christian was actually with us for that scene, he was actually filming that scene.
Yeah. I remember he even spent the night at my house one night. And the night Sarah Cusick's uncle come after me. Christian spent the night that night. I remember that. So that even that was... That was
but that rainy day that we shot the first whaling in scene, Peter had from work was in the back seat of Christian's car, and he kept on telling me to come get it. I said, I'll just get the damn thing later. And so him being pissed off, he left the computer in the parking lot.
Yeah.
At the White Star and drove off. And man, I don't think I talked to him again after that, but you all still kind of hang out with him a little bit.
And that brings us to...
To where you all started a small movie project called Tennessee Ghost House.
This is on a Sunday.
What was that? What was that?
This is on a Sunday. You were at work, and Christian had kept telling me and Justin all day, he said, these Slayer movies are stupid. Why we gotta keep doing Slayer for? Just do something else, what he kept saying all day. So finally I gave in. I said, okay, we got a whole prop bag here full of stuff. Let's do something different. I thought something paranormal would be cool. So that night we went to the Wailing Inn, put Justin in a mask, and put him in the corner. And then me and Christian went around the house looking around, and then we put Justin in the corners, or Justin would be. Or we put him in a corner and cut the camera off and then try to turn it back on with Justin being gone and make like a ghost appeared. And then, like a lot of our projects, we kind of got off track with it. So then on the way home that night, me and Christian's filming our little ride home, and then this ghost jumps out in front of the car, and we run over Justin going down.
What the? Oh my God! What is that?
Justin's laying in the middle of the
room. You showed me that night, and you were trying to.
Oh yeah, we were trying
to pass it off like that was really happening. I was like
we really saw a ghost. Yeah, you said, that's Justin. I said, that's Don. I said, this is real. I said, look at him. Ghost, and then Christian took the Tennessee Ghost House tape and tried to fool some people with it, which. Now I remember I was at Food City on that Monday, and he called and said, yeah, I'll show the tape to some people, and then they thought it was scary. They bought into it. So I think that was Christian's master plan to get Slayer out of the picture.
Yeah.
Christian.
And And then eventually he just kind of went away.
He fizzled out on Slayer 3 time.
And then we filmed Slayer 3. We did the entire filming of Slayer 3. And then I ended up meeting Christian, I think, at Kroger or somewhere, and we started talking a little bit. And then he agreed to come over to my house, and I showed him Slayer 3. And then I think he was kind of biting his tongue. He didn't really say anything bad about it, so we could kind of work things out. And then he agreed to be in Slayer 4. And so that's where we had him playing Harley the Landlord, and then we ended up getting him stuck in the at Food City.
And my biggest
the Jeremy Pipps character.
The things I hate the most, just it really irks me, is we never got to finish that movie. And thanks for that, because I really truly think that would have been the most entertaining, logical movie, because
that was on the road being a really entertaining movie.
Because we had all Harley the Landlord. I truly think Slayer 4, the original one, would have been good. Because we had creative ways thought up of how we were going to kill each character. Like, Nick was playing Randy, so he was going to get killed.
Cut your ass!
Oh, shit.
The killer's going to walk through the tape.
And then Hank was going to get killed.
He was going to think the killer was one of the boys.
Let you down.
Y'all got 30 minutes to get there and back.
Okay. We will not let you down.
I'm serious.
His work pulling around.
Oh, that would have been so fun. And then Christian had honestly had a good idea of using Ethel. He was going to play Ethel Baxter at the Wailing Inn.
Oh, yeah.
We was actually going to do a scene where we played old music, and we was going to take a. Like, there was a ghost of Ethel was going to appear in the house.
Yeah, and that was going to kind of add a paranormal, like, aspect to,
oh, that
to the
been...
Slayer franchise.
So we're going to have an old lady sitting in a rocking chair. She was going to vanish, and then the boys, which we were playing the Beavis and Butt characters, we were going to stumble up on the Wayland, the Baxter house.
Yeah.
And Ethel would have done been gone by that point. But that would have been a cool little creepy scene. We were going to be like, it was kind of like Friday the 13th 4, where he's going to have
what happened was...
So what happened was
Stepdad brought a turkey over here.
Oh, this...
This is depressing even talking about, isn't it? Because this is like the end of the awesome era. Your stepdad brought a turkey over here, and then we was like, we gotta use this turkey in a scene. So he's getting ready to get rid of the turkey, which I wish I just let him get rid of the damn turkey.
No, no, because it's what.
Yeah, he was gonna get rid of it, but I said no. I will get rid of the turkey. I will get rid of the turkey. I told Mike I would get rid of the turkey.
He said, all right. You better get rid of it.
All right, and so we used turkey in a scene.
The boys killed the turkey. Our characters were the boys.
Yeah,
we were the boys.
We killed the turkey, and then I think Christian was there now, because me and Christian were kind of friends again at that point.
Yeah, Christian was back around now.
So I had to go home for something, or I think I got out of there in a hurry. I left the turkey laying in the driveway.
Now I will honestly say something. I don't know. I can't put my finger on something didn't feel right that day, and I remember you said you had a date that night. I don't know what happened. You said you had a date, so me and Sarah. So there was two things. There's two things here. First off,
I wasn't really dating Amanda Soler at the time.
That's what we couldn't figure out. So Sarah Cusick came right after you all left. So now here's what started it. First off, I got a dead turkey out in the driveway, and I don't like touching dead things. So Sarah Cusick went out there, and I had my eyes shut, and we were putting the turkey in the bag, and I was furious because you left. This was your responsibility, and you left it in the driveway. So first I said, let's just take this and throw it in his driveway. And even Mike said, take that damn turkey, just throw it in his driveway. Get rid of the dang thing. He was supposed to get rid. So we went to your house, threw it in your driveway, and your car was there. So I said, he ain't got no date. See, his car is there. So now we were mad at you for lying, and you were mad at you for the turkey. So I said, that was the downward spiral on that. And you know what's sad? Just as fast as the era started, it all came crumbling just as fast. Because this was a Sunday, and by Monday we were already at war.
I remember Sarah Cusick called my cell phone after y'all left. She said, you might want to check under your car. And I was like, why? I think there might be a turkey underneath your car.
This is how fast this fun era.
And then I was like... are you kidding me? And I probably had those Daniel Hopkins veins popping out of my neck at that point.
And didn't your dad see the turkey? Didn't your parents?
Yeah, I was like, okay, well, I was like, my memory calls, I think I was like, screw it, and I think I went on the bed.
Just left it out there in the driveway.
You know, I didn't even go check. The next morning, my dad woke me up and said, there's a turkey underneath your car. And I slept with my remote control in my bed. And that was the first thing I grabbed. And I launched it towards my wall. And then I was like, I think I said every cuss word that was possibly available to use. I went out there and the damn turkey was underneath my tires. And I was like, so I got a bag, I put the turkey in, I tossed it over the fence in my backyard, and I was like,
what did it do? Just rot away? Just stay back there?
Yeah, it stayed back there. And then I guess the decomposed back there.
Okay, so that's a Monday. Already on that Monday, now there's a war going on. Me and Sarah going at it with you and Christian on a website. So that was Monday. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, I went to work. We weren't really in contact. Friday night, you were supposed to, okay, we invited you and Christian to come over. You, Christian, me, Sarah, Justin, Julie, us six. You all no-showed. So then at that point, I was like, I guess they're gone. Justin's like, I remember Justin said, I didn't lock his ass anyways. So that was pretty much your all's farewell. So we on that video game, SmackDown versus Raw, we did the Outsiders. We made me and Justin versus you and Christian, because we all made ourselves on that video game. Even Christian had made himself on there.
Yeah. At the time, like I consider myself done with you all. So me and Christian and Matt Hart, I am going to Guitar Center. And I bought a bass, and we were gonna start a band. That's what we did for pretty much 06.
So on that Friday night, we did. My blog title was that night was The Outsiders versus Chad and CLB, you creepy little bastard. That was it. So okay, then that night, Justin said, Justin talking about we didn't need you to make a movie. I had a camera, so we went out. We made a movie called This Is Some Scurry Shit, and it was just us out in the driveway scaring Julie or something. So we were gonna get in the short film business now. We were gonna start making short films. So what happened along the way now? So you're out of the picture. Christian's out of the picture. Nick and Carrie had just got married. They're living the married life. They're gone. Haji's gone. He'd been long gone for 3 months. Next, and then it just started. Okay, now Sarah Cusick started being a. She was a slut. She was going around from guy to guy behind my back. And I'd had enough of her. I got rid of her. So now Sarah Cusick's gone. Now it turns into me, Justin, and Julie. Now I'm the third wheel of this group. So now eventually they went on, started hanging out with Davis and Nikki more. Now that's it. I'm working at Food City now. February of 06, there's nothing going on. There's nobody, nothing going on. So I started talking to this girl named Sarah Claiborne at Food City. Now we got this blonde bagger, 16-year-old bagger named Sarah Claiborne that I found out like me. She started talking to me on AIM. And that's basically who I just talked to her all the time. Didn't see Justin and Julie no more, so second week of February, I went to her house to hang out, and we walked up the street. And then when we came back down, Josh Justice and Andrew Justice, her cousin, was on her front porch. Josh had a fake wrestling belt. And that's a story for the sequel.
Yeah,
it's so amazing. Like, here we have the Haji era. Me, Justin, Haji here. Now you come back around at this football game. All this fun stuff started happening. Christian comes along. Nick and Carrie come back. It happened that fast, and then it ended that fast. Within just because of a turkey. Is that not amazing looking back? It was like a chapter in a big book.
In a nutshell, you finished up the rest of 2006 for you was pretty much, or 2007, or 2006 for you was you did a XPW, you did this little wrestling thing, and then I came back briefly that summer.
No, because I had to wreck.
You had to wreck, so I felt kind of bad. So we briefly came back to do Slayer 4. And then.
Now let's talk.
And then.
Man, let's talk about this. There's no way to go back and change things, or and it all happened for a reason. But had the dead turkey not had been brought here, which, why in God's name was there a dead turkey here anyway?
So why did Mike have to bring that turkey?
The million-dollar question is, and this could be debated on, we'll never know a true answer, but had the turkey not have been brought here, would we have still all been friends? Would Slayer 4 have been completed like it's supposed to? Would we have kept on hanging out? Would it have still been me, you, and Christian, and Justin, Julie, Nick, and Carrie?
I don't know. Well, in relation to Slayer at the time, I think at that time I was getting kind of just sick of it. I think Christian kind of got into my head about how bad they were, and I was getting kind of sick of
that,
it.
I think I was sensing that. So I was sensing you. And I'll tell you something. Justin was burnt. Justin was fed up with him at that point. He liked doing.
I felt there should have been more time between 3 and 4 before we started 4.
And in my perspective was that, okay, Jimmy Lane saw Slayer 3. He wanted to be more death scenes. All these people at Food City now are wanting to see more Slayers, so now I'm all fired up now. I'm going 100 miles an hour. I want to go make another Slayer movie that week.
So I remember being at Justin's house, and Justin even got pissed at. He was like, I wish he'd chill out because you were getting kind of mad because we couldn't film or something.
Oh yeah.
And I was like, man, I wish he'd chill out a little bit. I remember like that was the same day that him and Bill got in the fight in the front yard.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I remember that it was kind of actually a good thing we took that break off, because the script for the new Slayer 4 actually turned out to be one of our best, better movies we ever have done. Had the, one of the best stories.
When I was in high school, I used to draw these comic book things just to pass the time off, and I'd write the comic books with our character, with Haji, and all of our gang members would be in these comic strips, and I always did a Jekyll and Hyde story with Haji. Haji was a character named Victor Hodge, and he turned into Buffalo Helton, and he's this evil guy go around town starting trouble at the bar. So that was I gave out to the Ash Bentley character. The movie stayed on track the entire time. It never got off track.
Actually, I watched that the other night, and I think it's flawless. I was into it. I watched everything in it.
I was off in my own little world. You was off in your own story, and then we kind of
meshed at the end there.
Yeah. And then the killer made his big return, and then
when Justin lived his long dream of actually playing the killer, because since we started those things, he always wanted to play the killer, and me and you were always the killer, so Justin finally got to be the killer at the end of the
movie. Julie did a good job in that movie. Biddle did a good job. Yeah. Everything went good. Yeah,
there was nothing wrong with that movie. And then unfortunately, our success was short-lived.
That was a short your brief coming. You were back for maybe a month.
Yeah, I was there just for that, and then on MySpace.
You went away within that week, and we finished the movie up on a Friday night. On Saturday, we didn't see each other. On Sunday, we went to the Andy Griffith play.
Oh, yeah, and then, yeah, I remember that.
It was supposed to be me, you, Justin, and Julie going, and Nick.
And then,
me, you, Justin, Julie, just us four.
Yeah.
They ended up not even going. They weren't even going to tell us they weren't going.
They had a car show or something.
But they weren't going to tell us, yeah. So I got mad at them. So then me, you've got, now we got two or three, sounds like us now almost. But me and you had two tickets. It's like, well, what are we going to do now? My mom don't want to go. So
didn't Nick show up?
Yeah, so we got Nick to go, and we got Brittany to go. So me, you, Nick, and Brittany ended up going, using the tickets, went to the church, had the barbecue dinner, watched the play. So I sensed something was going on in your head there. Some Amanda Stoller was working you there.
Yeah.
So,
and she was working me. I remember like on MySpace a few days later, you all had a fight. And then you went off on her and just cussed her the hell out.
Just like I did Trisha, Nick's girlfriend here a year ago.
And then me having to be the good boyfriend, I had to stick up for my girlfriend. So me and you had this big huge war on Facebook where we were just cussing each other out. Or not, it was MySpace, but MySpace back then.
Yeah, so I'm already Matt, Justin, Julie, so they're gone again. Just like 8 months earlier, it all fell apart again. Yeah. Justin, Julie went away, and you went away, and there we were right back at school. I started hanging out. Sarah Claiborne was still in the picture, and I went to the fair with Andrew Justice and Tiffany Sellers. The fair, you are at the Nickelback concert. I was at the fair with Andrew and Tiffany.
I'm on decent terms with them.
Yeah, so now you all, and then me and Daniel went to see Texas Chainsaw the Beginning, because my gang was me, Daniel, and then Casey Stout and Tiffany Sellers, and that's ironically who I made Slayer 5 with. So I jumped for my first time ever. Now I'm jumping into a Slayer movie. Like, you're out of the picture completely.
We're like, everybody's out of the picture completely.
Oh, yeah, this is all.
This is like all almost.
Well, I got Nick and Carrie back. Nick and Carrie.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they came back.
So the story of Slayer 5 is going to be a bounty hunter was to track down Sean Baxter. And Sean Baxter was going to get killed by the bounty hunter. But it was actually going to be
a fake one.
A fake Sean Baxter. Oh, yeah, because the bounty hunter had a dagger. The dagger was going to put Sean Baxter down for good, and he used the dagger on Sean Baxter. So you're watching this, bounty hunter walks off. You're like, why is the movie over? Why is this over in 20 minutes? And then the killer gets up. Just kind of just walks off. Because the killer was actually the owner of the camp. So I was happy with all that. And then there was some comedy stuff with Daniel and Nick. And Daniel played Bert. Nick played Mikey.
I remember Rocky, you gave Amanda the copy of it to watch the movie. And I actually sat down and watched it with Amanda. And I was into the very first part of it. But whenever you got Nick in there, like dancing around like an idiot, I like a goofball, and then Daniel plunged in the toilet. That lost me. Like I didn't think it was funny. I just thought it was.
If you really ridiculous. I'm honestly happy because if you watch it, it's like H2. It's got this strong 20 minutes where he goes tracks the killer down. It's got this 30-40 minute. Stuff in the middle where you're putting over the campers or getting their characters put across.
Yeah, but I didn't really care for the characters though because they were.
You didn't like Mikey and Melanie and Bert. No. You did not like Mikey and Melanie and Bert.
I didn't like Mikey.
Cameo. I was happy to it had a good strong opening. It had some comedy in the middle and then it got serious at the end. You find out that I'm the killer. I go around killing Daniel.
And I like the end whenever you killed all the worthless.
All
the worthless cast members.
And then I said, I killed them all. And the movie, you think the movie's over? And then there comes the real Sean Baxter.
Yeah. Killer again, so he's.
So and then you got Skyler, the fake killer, versus Sean Baxter. And Justin got to reprise his role as Sean Baxter. I was happy the whole movie. And then. Because we fought, it's the same where I fought Justin, the killers were fighting in the woods.
Yeah.
Justin actually said, hell, we should do wrestling matches. He said that we were out there, because we were basically doing a wrestling match anyway, so that's spawned.
Enter the second
season. Season 2 of XPW.
Which we will be saving all that talk for later.
So, I've grown to really. I went a few years thinking Slayer 5 was a train wreck, but now looking back, I was happy with the whole thing. I don't think.
So here y'all do the wrestling thing in 06, end of 06.
Season 2, second season went from November to January.
In January of 07, and then you had the Nick and Daniel little match, and we'll talk about it later, and then January of 07. That was the end of season 2, and the enter 2007.
Well, let's talk about January 07 real quick, because the XPW season 2 finale was Daniel versus Nick. Later that month, we was getting. Me and Daniel just wanted some time with Nick. We wanted to go out like we used to, like a guy's night out. Yeah. Carrie wouldn't allow that. So finally, me and Daniel just snapped on her. Daniel started calling her a bitch, and I don't know what have they got in a fight. And then Carrie, just like all girlfriends.
Oh, yeah. Your ex is from Nick from that point.
Yeah, so Carrie told Nick that, so Nick made his return in October of 05, and by January 07, Carrie and Nick, we parted ways. And I tell you what, this was a long parting of ways because once Nick ended up blocking, and it wasn't even a fight between me and Nick. It was a fight between me and Daniel with Carrie. Nick had nothing to do with this. I mean, we just wanted guys nights out with him, and then the ass goes and blocks us off AIM, and then that was it.
Kind of reminds me of a current event.
Yeah, same event, history repeated itself with Trisha, the fat cow. Trisha, so January 07, okay, Nick and Carrie are gone again. So me and Daniel and Haji hung out there in that winter. We went to Wailing Inn a lot. We scared Haji. March, April, so You came back. We did Slayer 6.
We did Slayer 6, which was a kind of
watered down a
take of the West Gamester Nightmare. We all played ourselves.
We did what we could with what we had to work with.
Yeah, it was basically just me, you, and Haji.
Daniel cameo.
Yeah, we got Daniel cameo. We got Justin cameo and Casey Stout cameo.
We did what we could. We did the best we could with what we had to work with. I thought the movie was good. You left again.
Yeah, I went
May of 07.
Yeah, I went on to college for May of 07.
Okay, and I tell you what, Slayer 6, I don't know what it was about Slayer movies that made people go away, but Slayer 6 is done. We're wrapped up. You're gone. Haji now started getting these ridiculous curfews. This is when the curfew started, so Haji's gone. Justin, seeing that we were back in the movie business, he went away. I started hanging out with a guy named Anthony Fletcher, which that was very brief, maybe two weeks. I started talking to a guy named Sarah Means, and that's who I spent my whole summer of 07 dating, Sarah Means. And then you made your return once again
in August.
August of 07.
And then that was around the time that Rob Zombie's Halloween was coming out.
And we needed to do a Slayer remake.
Yeah,
two years later,
it's time for a Slayer remake. And we had nobody to work with. We had nobody.
So we had this little boy.
I remember you talking about, there's some boy that used to come to this party.
There's a real nice kid up the street, what I always said.
Yeah, so.
Rides a scooter.
So I was like, hey, go get Brittany, go over there and get that Cody kid. We'll see if we'll want to do the scene. See, and he.
Yeah, I got this for my birthday. Sorry, I'm
a 13-year-old Cody Evans.
Hey, how you doing?
So you want me to play this young killer?
Yeah. So we did all those scenes and everything within like 2 days of hanging out with Cody. He started I guess let's talk about the first night with him, because the first night with him he actually got permission, and we took him to see Halloween at the Real Theater on 66.
Yep.
And on the way back is whenever you started having your attack, which is...
And the first time you have a massive panic attack, you don't know what it is. So you automatically think you're dying. So I went I was going down the road thinking I was hyperventilating, but didn't know I
remember you were trying to jump out the window of my car, and I was like, I had no idea who this Cody kid was really in the back of my first time meeting him. I was like, Cody, grab him, keep him from jumping out the window. And he's kind of freaking out in the back there.
That was actually my second attack. I had an attack 2 weeks earlier, and because now I went 2 weeks now, I kept asking myself, what happened that now? What was that? Why couldn't I breathe? That was my second one.
And then I remember your mom and sister took you to the hospital, and then me and Cody fought in the falling, and then me and Cody just kind of hung around the hospital the entire time. And
okay, so now we get
floors.
September 07, which I'll go on record saying that was the worst month, probably the whole worst time period of my entire life. I've been alive 27 years. That was the worst month, the whole worst time period of my entire life. That ranks up number one. That was just a bad. It was dull. And I was battling big time anxiety. I was on this medication, these little green pills. I couldn't even go pick Brittany up from school anymore. I had to go pick her up, not having an attack before I got home. I'd take a pill, and before I could even get home, I'd already just be like dizzy. The fatigue was already, it knocked me out.
I know that feeling.
So now I'm on anxiety medication, and then we're in the middle of a Slayer movie. We spent months weeks saying this Justin's gonna play this guy.
Yeah.
We might be able to get Christian
and we
back.
Couldn't get nobody.
I said, well, I know this girl named Brianna. Maybe we can get her to play this character. And so stars weren't aligned, right? And it can't. It's like
then talk about Cody for. I mean, like in the first day, he was really a really nice, sweet kid. And then like a couple days later, as we were continuing to attempt to shoot scenes with him, he started talking more like a black guy.
And, always wanted to fight
gangster,
and wrestle.
And he always talked about how many fights he got in high school and how tough he was, and he was gonna shake some homie down or something like that. he got unbearable. And he always wanted to
wrestle, and then he'd be like, "Oh guys, please stop! I'm tired."
And then
he'd punch you again.
And then you guys were kind of in the process of doing the third season of. Of HBW at the time, kind of off and on, like y'all started, then we did a little bit, we tried the movie thing, and then
we didn't know what the hell we didn't know what we were doing.
we kind of went back to when they were with Cody and everything, and then that was what got Cody to want to wrestle all the time.
Yeah, so we did a show called October Madness on October of 07. It was you and Cody in the backyard. So now we're back. Now we're season 3 of XPW. We finally just threw the towel on the Slayer remake. We didn't want to. We had high hopes for that. We wanted to do the cave and show how the demon came into the picture, but you had nobody to work with, though.
So we ended up scratching that, and then...
That was scratched. XPW was on fumes.
Yeah, and we did this little thing up on Desert Hill, and then that was it.
Yeah, I'd say that... when we went back to watch all those old shows, those were the worst shows...
Yeah, then I remember during that little fight we had, I got a little piece of mulch in my eye. That night I ended up having to go to the hospital.
Nothing from the whole fall of 07 was just god awful. I had a boring job at Kroger. I worked at, our Halloween party was me, you, and Cody.
Yeah, well, Cody did bring some people up there so we could scare them more. It was a little exciting there for the time.
Until my mom came out there and told us to get all those people out of there. And that kind of put a...
Yeah, and then look, we were walking them all back, and then I told Haji to watch out for Cody. So then me and you went back to the house or something, and then we saw Cody walk back, but there was no Haji. So I was like, Cody, you lost Haji. And like, Haji, my boy, where'd he go?
And then Hanji finally did come back about an hour later, and then he had his keys out, and he had to go home. It was curfew time.
He was past curfew at that point.
Oh, yeah, he was getting nervous. He had to get out of there, and I don't think we saw him anymore.
No, yeah, that was the end of Hanji for a while.
That might be that was the end of Hanji forever. He never came back around again.
Yeah.
He came around once or twice in 09, and that was it. Hanji was long.
Yep.
So that was the end of Hanji, and that was a dull period. Cody was like our gang was me and you and Cody.
Yep. And then we did the wrestling thing kind of off and on, and then 07 at the end of the Desert Hill thing we were over.
I had one friend at Kroger named Brad Kirkland.
I went back to school, so I was kind of gone. Like I that whole January I was like didn't like I disappeared again from the gang. I was in school.
Okay, so that's what you're doing now. I'm working at Kroger. I'm a cashier, and my bagger down here is Brad Kirkland. Brad Kirkland's talking about his backyard show, and I'm telling about how I used to do one, and the rest, that's for the sequel. And then XPW become a phenomenon.
It started back, and it became really popular, became bigger than ever we ever thought it would be.
Bigger every year.
It kept on growing through.
And our lives were changed.
Through 09, and then 09, we were...
I would say the final real gang was me and you and Cody in terms of not having anything wrestling related to it.
Yeah. And then 09, we got a random phone call or something, or a random pull-up from
Nick. After three, literally, Nick went away in January 07. Here we are, almost about to hit January of 2010. Here comes Nick. Found that Carrie had beat him up.
Kicked his ass, and they were done. They had a baby together at the time, and then Nick came back, and then that led to the New Year's party.
Nick had been away for 3 years. 3 years, no contact, not even seen the guy, and then he came back, and within a minute, it was like he never left. That's how you know. That was always the special thing about the gang and the clique, is you could not see these people for 5 years, and when they could come back around, it's like they never left. Yeah. I saw Daniel 2 weeks ago at Kroger, and we talked I ain't hung out or talked to that guy in forever. And
the funny thing, I don't know if I mentioned this earlier, but me and there was this kid named Smiley that we went to school with, and he used to to me and Daniel, he always do this thing he thought he just pushed us and kind and stuff. And I remember one time I bucked back up at him, and I shoved him into the chairs. So he's a kid I never liked, and then Daniel never liked him either, and then I didn't like Daniel either. There's like three of us that didn't really like each other, because I remember Daniel called me an effing prep in high school one time. So a week ago I was talking to Daniel, and we were kind of rehashed, and then Smiley walks up. So the three of us were kind of talking, like, whoa, we haven't seen each other.
We could make a DVD in itself on just fate moments like that. Moments that's just happened. We've been talking about somebody, and then here they are. And
So, yeah, we... So, in 2009, we had The Return of Nick. And then... And then that went on forever. And then eventually, and probably I think it was in the summer of 2010, you all had the falling out with Cody.
Yeah, because, yeah, that's... Because we told Cody, we invited Cody to go ride go-karts. Then, but before we could do that, Tyler and Joey wanted to go see the set. So me and Nick went over there to look at the set. We ended up, you know, we can't go to Tyler's without talking for 2 hours. Yeah. Cody was now getting impatient because he said, "That's bullshit. I heard him got home and now y'all are making me wait." So it got so old and I was getting so annoyed. Then he started calling Nick's phone going off. And Nick said, "He's getting mad and he's getting annoyed." I said, just tell him we're not going." So Nick said, and Nick lied and said we were going to go hang out with Howard and Martha. I had to go do something with them. And Cody said, "Oh, okay." Well, we ended up inviting Tyler and Joey and Amy to go to ride go-karts with us instead. And what did Amy do? Amy posted it on Facebook that we were all there. And Amy and Cody are friends on Facebook, so yeah. Cody knew that. And that led to Judy's big butt coming over here trying to charge into my house like a bull trying to fight. said he lied to a kid. That's what she said. My mom and Mike were having to hold. She was literally trying to attack me, and she was crying. She's like, he lied to a kid. You don't do that to a kid. He said they lied to him. She was charging at me. That was the end. I've now talked to the guy since.
Yep, and then Cody still hasn't really forgiven that because every time I talk to him, he doesn't have anything to do with you. So I think that friendship is completely dead in the waters. There's no resurrecting that ever. So Cody's gone into the summer of 2010, and then we got a surprise in February of 2012.
Yep.
Big J shows back up. We went balling.
Because we just happened to see him at the mall during Christmas time.
Yeah, and during Christmas time, 2011.
I remember you mean you walked up to him and started looking at him for a minute. Phyllis had this weird look on her face, yeah. like she couldn't believe we were standing there. Like she couldn't believe
we're back.
Yeah.
So we
hadn't talked to. Oh yeah, Justin was gone for 2.5 years.
Yeah.
Nick stayed away for 3 years, and Justin. From Black Friday 2009 all the way until December, late December of 2011, Justin was gone for two years and 2 months. Justin was not even in our lives. Didn't even talk to him, and there he was at the mall. And we talked like nothing had ever happened, and that led to the bowling trip in February of 2012.
And then Justin was pretty much back. We'd see him every so often. And then it's later 2012.
And it points out Nick. We had our departure with Nick because I got to fight with Trisha. Yeah. So Nick's gone.
Yeah.
So Nick came back around. It's so ironic because Justin went away in November of 2009. And just weeks later, Nick came back around. So we spent 2010 and 2011 with Nick. And then early 2012... I got in a fight with Trisha, so me and Nick parted ways, and then Justin, the bowling trip.
Yep.
So, is that not, it's so ironic, and it just looks like fate, like, they Justin and Nick coins, it's like they weren't meant to be around each other.
No. We even had Justin wanting to, like, pass things up and hang out with Nick again.
But then
Trisha caused this big falling out, So that pretty much prevented that ever really happened.
It's so odd. Justin and Nick just coincide with each other.
Every single time. They always do.
So then we'd hang out with Justin every so often in 2012.
And then we finished the wrestling thing up for good.
Yeah.
We're
in October now.
Yeah, so yeah, we...
Okay, October the 15th, 2012. October 15th, 2012 was a Monday. And now we are completely 110% done with wrestling. It's done.
Yes, it's officially out of past.
So now, around that same time period, we start hanging out with Destiny and Marie and
just random people we saw from the we met at the wrestling show. We were trying to.
Tony Lane.
We were trying to assemble a new gang.
Okay. Here we are. It's okay. So wrestling's done. We were at 26 years old. We weren't going to go make another Slayer movie. So now we needed a new. Gang.
Another thing, just to kind of go with my horrible 2012, this about the wrestling was horrible, which we will talk about. I ended up losing my job at the end of August of that year. So I was on a very depressed. Like I was wanting anything fun to do just to get my mind off everything, because I was about to lose my house that I worked so hard to get. I've been living it for 2 years, so I ended up losing that and everything. So I was just wanting to find a group that I can go and I have fun with. So I was trying to assemble a gang.
Okay, so you've lost your job. Wrestling's on its deathbed. We're about to be done with wrestling. My master plan was to make a new gang. Not try to go get Nick back. Not try to go get any of those people. But we needed a new gang. It was new people that we could go hang out with on the weekends. Go ghost hunting with. So that's. But then. I don't know why, but people just started dropping like flies. Now we're at a point, and it all led to, okay, Fanboy Expo now. Fanboy Expo, me, you, and Gary went to meet Jason Deffrank.
Gary was the last remnant of the new game that we were trying to put together. He was...
When we were in Sonic, we met Jason Deffrank that night. It was a Saturday night. We were sitting there at the end of October and said, man, it'd be cool to get a game to come here and just come to Sonic and just eat and just go film movies and have fun. Okay, we took Gary home on that Sunday, and then now we're all over. The big countdown's on for Halloween on October 30th.
Yeah, the 1978 classic Halloween was coming back to the theater.
And we're really going to gang.
We were going to get this big gang, and everybody's going to go see it.
Okay, so that day came along, and everybody...
Nobody showed up.
And then there was a guy in the... In spring of 2007, I met a guy named Dylan Gilmore, who was a bagger at Food City. So he was even going to go to the Halloween movie, and even he made a brief comeback there in the last days of the wrestling. So we thought at least we'd have Dylan and Gary, and then we lost.
Gary wanted to go hang out with Kyle that night.
Oh yeah, okay. So me and you
And then Dylan had something else to do.
Yeah, so me and you went to see Halloween on October 30th.
It was just the two of us
sitting in a theater.
The two of us. Can you imagine how gay that looked? Two guys in the movie theater. I never liked going to a movie theater with just another guy. It was just us two, and then we were screwed by everybody that we tried to invite.
No, because I made an event invite. Everybody was gonna go. Everybody was gonna go see this movie. We had Paranormal Activity 4, which everybody went to with us, but then. When it came time for Halloween, and me and you just sitting in a theater. Scream wasn't even that big. It was like a little tiny screen.
Yeah. And then it wasn't even that packed of a movie, really. There wasn't too many people there.
Okay, now we come to, tonight sucked, but we're gonna make Halloween. We're going to make up for it tomorrow.
Yeah,
we're going to make Halloween awesome.
We were going to, like,
We're going to go to the haunted thing beside Daniel's Bar and Grill.
Yeah, we were going to go to the haunted houses. We were going to go to... We're gonna get the group together to go rolling or something, or go to the Whalen Inn or something. We were gonna have a good Halloween.
Here we go. October the 31st, 2012. Probably the worst night, not in terms of bad things happening. It's just dull and just. So for some reason, it was being yelled in our ears that like the gang's history. It went from being sad and depressing to just comical, how bad it was getting. First off, I was in there cleaning my room on Halloween, because at least I knew that later that night, me and you and Amanda were going to go to the haunted thing.
That was a weekday, wasn't it?
That was a Wednesday.
I think I was working at one of the schools at that time, so I was getting off. I was still thinking that maybe you would have assembled a gang at that point. I was going to come over to your house. We were going to meet up with everybody. Whenever I came up to your house, you're in a bad mood, and you're like, I forgot what you said. Something along the lines like, other people have got so many plans and stuff. So
I called Dylan, and Dylan said, yeah, there's this thing going on in Cherokee Hills. We'll go to that, and I'll call you back in 30 minutes. Well, I waited, and he never called back. So then we're like, well, we still got the thing with Amanda. So
Amanda took her kids out trick or treating.
So she never texted back.
And
we drove.
She forgot good and late. She couldn't because she couldn't make it.
So then we Kilgore. Kilgore was gonna go. Kilgore texted you and asked you about the Whalen Inn. And then we thought that was our property. So we said nobody's gonna go to the Whalen Inn but us.
Kilgore was a guy that I knew from church, and we also wrestled with him. He was somebody that's coming back from the past. He texted because he knew about the haunted house. We thought we'd have Kilgore with us go to the...
But we left something out, though. The reason, it wasn't just that this was... we had had times like this happen before, but this was Halloween. This was like our
this was our night. We were
Halloween was like it was like that one day of the year we look forward to. Halloween was the day you know, Halloween was always my favorite holiday as a kid, and it still is. But then, like, then Halloween 2012 came along.
It's not for me anymore. It's Halloween's just another day for me now.
So, okay, 9:45. Okay, so I said, "Ah, screw it. Let's just me and you go to the haunted thing." We went there, and they were the stuff was inflated.
They were closing.
They were closing. Okay, so we went to Amanda's house. Her
car was there, but the lights were kind of off. So it was like they probably turned in.
Well, okay, we go up, we drive up. Let's go sit down and see Kilgore's at the Whalen Inn. Go down there, and it's just nothing.
Just empty house.
Empty house. It was almost like we could just go drive, and you didn't have a job, and it was almost like we could just go drive our car off a cliff.
And no one would give a
damn. Nobody to give a damn. And then, my God, it just got worse, because now we hit November, and then, probably the dullest month
ever.
I remember I thought the Haji era of 05 was bad. This brought new meaning to the word dull. This now I'm just going to work. It'd get dark at 5:30, the business would die off. It's just, I'd go home, be nothing to do, just go work the next day. It was just a depressing time. I remember reading a status you wrote on a Saturday night. You said everybody's moved on with their lives, nobody gives a damn anymore. What was that?
I forgot what it was. I mean, like, everybody's got their own married life now. They're doing their own thing. Like, just no one cares anymore. So it's something like, I can't quote it word for word, but that's
pretty okay. So word. Okay, now we're in an era where it's just me and you, and that was it. Everybody from the wrestling days were gone. The clique was gone. There was no reminiscence of the clique whatsoever. Dylan was gone. The people went to the Whalen Inn with was gone. There was just did nothing. And then the end of November, then Mike fell. Mike become paralyzed.
Yep, he's now paraplegic.
December came along. Nothing. There's nothing to even talk about. It was nothing.
And then the house was empty because it was just you and your sister and your mom here. And Mike was still in the hospital at that point that entire time.
Yeah, we would start making jokes saying we were going to hook another TV up in here so the gang could play Nintendo. So we'd have two TVs.
We would occasionally get visits from Justin every now and then.
Yeah.
During that
just point. talk about old times. How good things used to be.
Yeah, how good things used to be because obviously things weren't good at that point.
I ended up calling the era, and I still call it that. It's called the era of nothing. And then January.
There was nothing.
January 2013. And even our New Year's Eve, it was just me and you. And me, you, my mom, and my sister were here. New Year's Eve, dating all the way back to 02 and 03, used to be huge. We used to have New Year's Eve parties over here.
Yeah.
Things still weren't getting. November, December, and January. It's ironic. November, those same months in 05 were like our most memorable months of our lives. And then here you go, 2012, our stressful wrestling career is over. Now we think we're going to be moving on to the fun life now.
But in 05, we were 20 years old, 19 and 20 years old.
Yeah, now we're 20.
Now we were 26 and 27 years old.
Okay, so January of 2013, we get the occasional visits from Justin. That was basically... Still nothing. The era of nothing was continuing. Now that's where you made the decision to join the Navy, I believe.
Yeah. What led to that was I was doing these video things. I was trying to make my life look more positive and not be so depressed and everything. So I was making these video things. Well, somebody got a hold of that and thought I looked like I was hot or conceited or was full of myself and everything. And then my parents actually told me that they were scared of me. Thought that I was going to go crazy, and they said that they's like, you need to stop doing this crap. You need to go out and find a job. And I was like, well, I've got nothing really going on right now. I could use some help going to school and stuff.
The gang's gone.
I called a Navy recruiter, and that I got ended up putting in. I passed all my physical and everything, so I'm actually shipping off. By the time everybody sees this, it'll be June. After June 1st, so I will be shipping off in a month.
July the 15th and 16th.
I'll be gone. So and then that will be starting my new life there, and I will be out of here for 4 years. So that's where I'm going.
No, okay. There was one night in January where we was gonna try to make something happen. So we went to the Texas Chainsaw 3D. Another miserable night. We invited had Kyle and Gary go on. They were wandered off somewhere.
Didn't care anything.
They just walked up that we
actually wanted to invite them and wanted to hang out with them.
Kyle was gone before we even got out of the car.
Yeah.
Kyle went behind the building with another guy.
And they cared more about their pot than they did us.
Okay, Destiny showed up. Destiny, who we thought was one of our good friends. She acted like she didn't even know us.
Yeah, she came with her sister or some other people, I guess, or somebody, and they were off their own selves.
AJ Riggs showed up. AJ Riggs, and it was like...
It was kind of awkward with him.
Yeah, awkward because there was nothing to talk about.
So basically, it was just basically me and you again.
With
a bunch of strangers.
Yeah, so we went in the theater. Now I get a text. The movie starts. I'm getting to the movie, and then just after 2 minutes goes downhill and starts sucking really bad. And then Chris Vick, a new friend, he started texting me saying he was in the theater, so I had to get up, go sit with him.
And then left me with the strangers.
You were with the strangers, and I'm sitting down there, and he wasn't in the movie, so he kept getting up every 5 seconds, and I was just waiting for this damn movie to end.
The movie was god-awful. It was one of the worst movies I wasted. Oh, yeah, also, I ended up paying for Gary's ticket, even though he kind of just wandered off and didn't really give a crap, pretty much.
That was January 4th of the month.
And then the top of it all, the movie was horrible. So it wasn't even good. Like, nobody even enjoyed the damn thing.
So then just everything started still not going downhill, just going in a direction. Just going in, life was just going in a stale. It's like, nothing was going on.
That's when the video stuff started really... I hit the fan, and then that's when I finally made the decision to join the military.
Finally, we said...
So I made that decision, and that's where I'm going, so...
You made the decision. Then it became time to, let's just do a documentary. Let's do a documentary and hope we can get some pique some interest from these people. Maybe they'll come along and help us out. So January began the documentary. February, we worked on the documentary. It rained every day, almost. Another dull month.
So here we are.
March, what happened? March, dull month.
Every month was dull. I can say every month you worked, I worked. We did a little bit of the documentary, and we didn't have any. We didn't really hang out with anybody.
But then
that's pretty much it.
Okay, then there was an episode of Dallas called JR's Masterpiece where he had this big plan in place. So now I was inspired to make a master plan to once again make a new gang, and we were successful for maybe a weekend. We had a gang go with us on that Friday to see Evil Dead, and on Saturday we had a little gang to go with us to the Wailing Inn, and on Sunday we had a little gang here watching WrestleMania. So for one weekend only, we were blessed with this really good week with just these different groups of people from Friday through Sunday.
Yeah.
And then, of course, just life went back to still.
Yeah.
Nothing happening.
I mean, one fun thing that happened, which was actually, like, didn't involve anybody else, it was just me and you, but we actually drove to Morrison and went to the original filming location of The Evil Dead.
Yeah, they burned it down. This is the roof. Pieces of the roof. Yeah, it was in mid-April of...
2013.
Yep.
And we actually went to that location and stood there where Bruce Campbell and all those other actors stood, and the actual cabin was actually burned down in the 80s.
And then the night after that, you went away for about 10 days.
Yeah.
11 days. So
I was gone for over about 2 weeks.
You took a brief break. I at that point, I didn't know if you were going to come back around. I didn't know if the documentary was done. I didn't know what was going on. And I went and saw two movies, and then you made your return. And then when you start hanging out with Amanda, we had another little string of good days there.
Yeah,
so.
We hanging out with Amanda, then we went to Gatlinburg.
And now we're in this
two days in a row.
Now we're in this kind of era where, like, it's not dull, and we do get some. Now it's just like, we do get a few good days here and there. Now
I'll look at it like I'm getting ready to leave this place in 4 years, and I want to have some fun before I leave.
And last week we did actually have fun. On Monday we went to Gatlinburg, Tuesday Gatlinburg, Wednesday what did we do Wednesday? There was a string of good days there. We worked on the documentary. When we revisited our old locations.
Yeah, I think we visited some old locations. I think Wednesday we went to Justin's, and we went to my old house. And
no, that was Thursday.
Oh, yeah, it was Thursday. I don't did anything Wednesday. I think you worked.
No, Wednesday we went to the Wendy's parking lot and all that.
Oh, yeah, Wailing and stuff.
So now life's gotten, it's never going to be good like it used to be. But it's not dull like it was in October, man. And we do get these random cameos. Life's like a... Our life's always been like a TV show. And we get these cameos. These little random things. Sometimes we'll see Justin somewhere. Mando will pop in and out.
Well, this documentary is actually... Is aimed towards the clique from high school. So now that our journey is kind of... we're hitting the end here. Well, I thought it'd be kind of fitting to go to look at each member of the gang and then we'll tell you kind of where they are now. So
let's start with the key members. If we used to do a rise and fall of the gang, we'd have to put key members on the cover. And first off, in that little group, I'm talking about the core members of the gang. There was members like there was Casey Noah. He was kind of the
besides you and me. I think the third big player would be Justin.
Yeah.
For me, since I wasn't really part of the high school part. I kind of joined the loft during high school, but '05 stuff, I consider Justin being like
the third. If somebody asked me in high school who my best friend was, I can honestly never, because you were out of the picture. Justin and Nick were 50-50, because yeah. Justin would date Carrie, and I'd hang out with them, and me and Justin would be like, be with some butthead, and we were close, and we'd go to Wendy's and play pranks, and then there was Nick, who I could get in the car with and go halfway across Tennessee, go to Westtown Mall, we could have a hell of a day, just us two. So, you talk about being blessed to have two. There was no putting one over the other. Nick and Justin were just equal, so... To me, looking back, I think they both played major parts in my life. Especially during high school, it's always just Justin and Nick were just equal. So, Justin now, let's cover him first.
All right, Justin works, he's actually in a supervisory management position at Gray Hodges now. He worked his way up from being a truck driver to actually being a supervisory management type position there. He works all the time. And whenever he gets off work, he works some more, doing some...
He goes most of the yards.
He mows yards.
Works on his truck.
He works on his truck and everything. And I think he helps his, Mr. Bill's business.
Yeah.
Occasionally, so.
Bill and Sons. Okay, Bill's, Nick yeah. Martin.
Oh.
Another key member of the group.
He was a key member of the group, and I'm...
I gotta say, I really hate that it has to be like this. When we talk about memories, anytime we talk about an old story, we can't ever tell an old story without saying the word Nick, because he was tied up in so many memories. But he's the biggest asshole.
Even the days whenever we're sitting around doing nothing, like he'd be like, "Well, we could really use Nick right now," because
Nick was once
he would just show up. And we could go somewhere.
The one that was really when we was going through our dull period last. Or October, November, December. Nick was one that was really missing because he'd just come over, you'd get in the car, and he'd drive you anywhere you wanted to go, he'd take you. We could go to get from Gatlinburg to West Town, back to East Town, to here, and leave and go somewhere else. And we'd take 12, we'd go on Sundays and spend 12 hours driving around.
Yep.
We'd hit Target, anywhere we wanted to go. So all of our big time memories, like, you can't ever. I don't think a day goes by we don't mention Nick somehow. Crazy driving and
yeah, he's definitely part of our history there, and it would have been unfair to mention him as big of a dicky as he is.
And it's sad he's a dickhead and just like he flipped us off just a few days ago.
Yeah, we were actually filming a scene for this documentary, and he drove by. And he actually flipped us off.
And it's sad because I was his best friend from fourth grade.
You saved
his life.
You mentioned earlier you saved his life and everything.
From fourth grade all the way up until.
And he probably wouldn't have had a single friend if it wasn't for us.
He'd have been. You talk about a loner. You talk about somebody who wouldn't have had a friend because he made all these friends because of me. From the moment I saved his life all the way to late 2011, I was his best friend. I cared enough about him to go put him in a Craigslist ad up to get him a girlfriend because I was tired of him talking about suicide stuff.
Yeah.
And I'd be damned if he didn't sit there and just throw us away like we were nothing.
I hope he watched this.
You are a son of a bitch.
Finally, the truth is out. He set the ad up on Craigslist
for
Trisha to come see you.
Yeah.
And then
Trisha and me worked it out to where he would never know. He was to think she was a Facebook person just stumbled along his profile.
So he did his part, and he's an asshole. He doesn't give a shit about anybody that ever.
And he only comes crawling back.
Gave anybody to him. So if while I'm gone, if he starts crawling back, I'm like, you better not give him your ass to kiss. All right.
Next, the third. Okay, I don't want to rank you, babe, because they were all so such important.
Amanda actually owns her own hair salon now, off of 411. It's called Looking Good.
She had her backs in 2011. She bought a ring for us.
Yep, she
let us use her house.
Yeah, let her use her house. After high school, she married John Piper, and then she had two kids, Johnny and Natalie.
Amanda's somebody you can talk to about anything. It's just
I can just pull up in her driveway and start talking, and she doesn't even care. She's glad to listen and help. And
we find out all the, like, we exchange stories. Yeah. Try to figure out what all is going on around the town.
Yeah, find all the gossip around the town. And everything, yeah.
Next would be Daniel Hoppe. Yep.
Daniel's, I think he just had his 10-year anniversary working
at this Kroger.
This October will be his 10-year anniversary working at Kroger.
Which, and then this is where what I was talking about, where we always had to bring up Nick. Nick got Daniel on at Kroger. If it hadn't been for Nick, Daniel would have never been at Kroger, because Nick put the good word in. So, and we're going to release this documentary the day of Daniel's wedding.
His wedding, which he's marrying the girl that we went to school with, Rachel Byers, who also works at Kroger.
And so Daniel's been at Kroger for 10 years. They're probably making really, really good money.
I think that's how they started dating, because of the Kroger job.
And then they have a little boy
together, Grayson. So I don't talk to them that much. From what I can tell, they're still doing good.
And then those were the key.
But we had some, like, B players, kind of like Gina.
Okay, let's talk about the B players. There's Gina.
Briefly, Justin came back in 2007 for when me and him went to her wedding.
Yeah, and then we hung out with them recently when we went to the Wailing Inn.
We went with her and Bethany to the Wailing Inn. It's like, I'm really not sure what she's up to. I know she's still married to I don't even know the guy's name that she married, but
I forgot. From the moment you stole her red Power Ranger to the moment she beat her ass because we hit her with the pillow when she got out of the tent bed, to the moment to where she went with us to the Wailing Inn just weeks ago, she played an important part of our lives. Gina was part of some. She was at my very first party.
Good memories with Gina.
Good memories with Gina. Another member, Casey Noah.
Casey Noah, yeah.
B player. He was. I don't want to say B player in terms of, like, they weren't. They played. They were temporary. They came and they were. Then they kind of went away.
And
Casey Noah, funny guy.
Yeah, I know Casey that well, but we always saw each other in the hallway, and we'd always talk. And I know I don't know what branch of the military he went into. But after high school, he did join the service for a little while. I'm not sure exactly which one he went into, but he's back now. I think he's still living around Seymour, maybe.
Red Mize.
I haven't seen Red Mize. I haven't heard from Red Mize
If I had to pick some key moments for Red Mize, it was senior skip day of 03. He went to the homecoming game. It was like that homecoming day there. Yeah. And the day when me and Nick rode around in his car and his brakes went out, and we thought we were gonna die.
Oh yeah.
He stole my Sega Genesis on that day of Halloween of 03 and went and pawned it somewhere. I didn't like that too much. And another key Red Mize moment was he went to the Julie Perry party with us, Halloween party. Oh, and summer of 03, spring, summer of 03, he came around a lot. He'd come over, he'd spend the night here sometimes. He was at the parties, and him and Mike McKee, he installed Mike's CD player, and Red Mize, another important part of our gang during that time. He worked with him at Wendy's.
But I just haven't heard from him in years, literally. I literally haven't heard from him in 9 years. I don't think I've seen him once since we graduated.
Other people of the gang?
Fampy Cleveland.
Fampy Cleveland, oh gosh.
And which we haven't mentioned him really in this documentary either. You will see pictures of him at some of the parties.
Went to the football games with him.
His mom was our lunch lady, Edie.
Yeah, he had a party there in June of 03.
I met him in lunchtime. Like, me and Justin were in, had the same lunch together in sophomore year when we met. We just started talking to him. He was a freshman. We were sophomores. We started talking to him and hanging out with him. And he became one of our lunch friends. That's how I kind of knew Christopher, which we y'all later named him Vampy.
Magina named him Vampy Cleveland.
But yeah. But he's doing pretty good. He just recently saw on Facebook where he bought a house, and he's a police officer a deputy with the Sevier County Sheriff's Office, and he's actually the school resource officer now at the Seymour Middle School.
Okay, Nicole Dockery, she was the quiet one of the gang. She was more Amanda's friend.
She's more like a C player.
Yeah, well, that's how I call C player Ashley McGill.
Oh yeah.
Like, you talking about somebody I just didn't really in high school didn't like that much. Me and her got into it quite a bit in Todd Napier's class. Me and her were just different. She was kind of there. Carrie was a big part of my life, especially dating Justin and Nick both.
Yeah, she dated Justin, then she went to Nick, married Nick, divorced Nick.
I used to eat lunch with Carrie one of those semesters. It was just me and Carrie sitting there.
And then she ended up dating Bobby Haynes there for a while.
But honestly, I miss talking to Carrie. I miss having her as a friend. It was always fun, me and Justin wrestling and her sitting there and thinking how to call us how stupid we were. Overall, she's probably one of the ones I miss talking to and hanging out with. It's Carrie. Jesse Housewright.
Jesse Housewright. He's the reason that we're here right now. honestly.
Jesse Housewright, he'll be more known as just our school friend. He came over to my house once in seventh grade, and then he got homesick. He had to go home by 5:30. Jesse Housewright, another big part of our lives, but more just a part of our school days. Yeah. He wanted somebody that would come over. He wanted somebody that would come to the parties.
I already mentioned the part where he's the one told me that you and Justin all went to the football games, and that led to me coming back and starting the fun era there.
Yeah, and then.
And then I remember sitting at the lunch table with him. We started talking about the tornado that hit that year and stuff like that. He always said he wanted to be a meteorologist.
Yeah, I remember that. I think so. We just named those what we just named. The fact that we can't come up with anybody else right now shows that was.
We can go ahead and mention Christian since he actually did.
Yeah, help I was gonna say.
He was nearly part of the high school game, but he did play an important part in 05 in the fun time. So.
It was this me, you, Christian, Justin, Nick, Carey kind of group, and we kind of split up there with Justin and Nick. Christian dropped his retainer. Remember the?
Oh yeah. We were at McDonald's one time, and Christian actually dropped his retainer, and Justin's girlfriend at the time actually dug through the.
That was a fun night because it built throughout the day. These are the kind of days the reason I think we get so down sometimes is because we want days like this. We went to Justin's house to film a movie scene.
Yeah,
we came back here, and Justin came here, and we filmed another movie scene.
Like back in 05, like every day was nonstop fun.
Yeah,
October, November, and December 05 was just nonstop, like,
action-packed. Friday night, movies. Justin come over here, we do a wrestling scene, we get in the car, we go to Pigeon Forge. You bought a Shawn Michaels book, which ironically came out the same week as the Vince Russo Forgiven book, so... I bought the Russo book. You bought the Shawn Michaels book. And then we went to McDonald's, and Christian dropped his retainer in the trash can, and Justin's girlfriend Chelsea dug for it, and it just every day was fun. I think we ended the night by going to Food City to see Raven Kiefer and Paul Segun and all them were working. So I mean, you just talk about every.
And Christian has his own house now. He works for a computer company called NCR, or a cash register company, and he. He's doing good. He actually helped us a little bit with this documentary here. So,
Cody Evans.
I told him I'd give him a shout out also.
No, shout out to Christian Brendel
and Brittany. I got to mention Brittany more. Brittany Riffey, his girlfriend.
And Cody Evans, part of the clique, part of the group. I really don't give two craps about him, but
yeah, I still talk to Cody every now and then. That war thing between you and Cody had nothing to do with any of that stuff. So I last saw Cody on Easter, which was about. A little over a month ago, or about a month ago, something like that. He actually drove me to church, and we talked then, and tried to mention you, and he still has no. He still has a big grudge about that. But.
Man, you know what's weird? We forgot about Haji. Oh crap! Boys going over our A team players. We left. That just shows you.
Well, that shows you if you screw us over, you can become forgotten.
Yeah, this stupid ass, like, I mean, 18, 19, 20 years old, he can come down here at any time and stay the whole weekend. And then now he's 23 and his dad's going to stand out in the driveway at 7 o'clock at night because I got him home at 1 minute late. It's supposed to be, it's 7:01 and Kenny's out there with his hands on his shoulders. They go, okay, 2008, Haji would have been 23 and couldn't even, he had to go burn his pornos. Now the guy can't even come around at all, and he's
pushing 30.
I have to say, if we call him, the name we give him, Old Man Haji, is just really, it's a good name for him. He's an old man.
On the reality, we're in our late 20s. We're like 30s might be fun, but you're only in your 20s once, and it's a damn shame if you act like you're old men if you're in your 20s.
Okay, we asked him to come help us do some of the primary school stuff, and he just passed the road that the school was on.
He had to hurry up.
Couldn't turn his car around.
He was going to come over tonight, and I was going to try to see if he can do an interview tonight, and he wouldn't.
Oh, he had to watch Raw tonight.
And that was the big Raw night, I guess. Yeah.
And, of course, he can't come down anytime during the week because he has to be at work. He can't come down at 7 p.m. because he has to be at work at 3 a.m.
Y'all wonder why I've had this huge issue with Haji over the past 23 years I've known him.
So yeah, I think I think Justin and Nick, they're neck and neck in terms of being the two probably most important people, and then Amanda, of course. But Amanda, kind of, we didn't really see her after high school, so.
Yeah, she started married life and started a family right after high school.
And Daniel talked to me 2 weeks ago. I was going to see Scary Movie 5, and Daniel sent me a text, and he was talking to me a little bit, and he did say something to me that really meant a lot. He said, no, even though we haven't talked in years, he said, you're still my best. He told me I was still his best friend.
Oh.
So, and then I saw him. I just happened to see him at Kroger, and we never stopped talking. Another person I wish would come around, I wish could come around more often is Daniel. Daniel really didn't have my back during all the periods where there wasn't a you or a Justin or anyone. Daniel was always around there. He went with me to see Texas Chainsaw the beginning, and we always went to prank Haji at the haunted house. So he fizzled out in about 07, when we really stopped hanging out with him because he was dating a girl named Britta Gaddis. And then the wrestling thing, we just never talked to him again.
And then we're seriously winding this down right here, and then. It's almost just kind of sad because I really don't want to see this documentary end. Because we've got like going back to all the schools and my old house and all these locations. It's actually been like a nice stress reliever and everything. And with me leaving in a month, and this is kind of like my farewell to you all for a long time. So I'm kind of like I really don't want to see it end right now.
It's your farewell and kind of.
It's probably kind of a farewell to the whole gang, because at this wedding that we're going to give this documentary out to,
June 1st, 2013.
It's going to be the last time it might possibly be the last time we're all ever in the same area.
I think
area.
Most definitely it's going to be the last time we're all going to be in the same area.
So we're going to get a group picture and everything, and everybody's going to get a copy of this.
It's probably going to be the most epic.
Even Hodge, you'll get a copy of it if he can show up.
This, I think this is going to be.
We bashed him, and I hope Nick gets a hand on a copy of this also.
I think our group picture is going to be the most epic picture that probably the most epic picture we'll ever be a part of, because these people have meant so much to our lives at one point or another. I can't imagine my life without any of these people.
Even if we bashed the hell out of you in this documentary, which there's two people that we definitely did. I couldn't definitely imagine life without either one of them.
I couldn't imagine life without Justin. I mean, because we had all those good Wendy's times, and all these key people were put in a place for a reason. Like, me and Justin had so many great memories. Nick most definitely was put in my life for a reason. Nick had my back there a lot. I still understand why he always disappears the way he does. Daniel, Haji, Amanda, and then of course you. I'm glad all these people were put in our lives, and I don't think I think it's very rare for a person to have the kind of bond with the friends that we had.
Yeah, there's I can quote a line from Stand By Me. It's a good movie that written by Stephen King and is directed by Rob Reiner. It says, "You will never have friends like you had whenever you were a certain age." And we were blessed and lucky enough to have the perfect group throughout our life.
And a lot of people were some people questioned the documentary, didn't quite understand why.
While we're doing this,
but they don't understand.
Because our lives meant that much to us. Not this whole group meant so much to us that we wanted to go back and we wanted to document everything.
Their friends are druggies. They do drugs. They don't understand why we would want to go back and like it's because we were blessed with good friends.
We had awesome friends.
We were blessed. You grew up in the 90s, a very good time period to grow up in. We were raised good. We had some of us had stricter parents than others, but we all were good. Like you and Eddie.
Yeah.
And then Sharon, Eddie, and. Who's the other one? And Kenny were always the strict parents. And even Tammy Curtis.
Yeah.
She was always strict. And then I had Rick. So we were all raised good.
We all had a good, moral, strong kind of upbringing.
And all my summers, I'd spend summers with Justin. I'd spend summers with Nick. Nick's grandparents always took care of me. Phyllis and Eddie were always really, really good to me.
So if you think what we did, like this thing is stupid, then I mean you're entitled to your opinion. But this was kind of our farewell and our.
But a lot of people don't have
our respect to our
respect our, to our
group,
our group, the way
in our past, and all the fun times that we have that we probably will not be getting back, but we will always have memories, of course, which the memories are documented on this tape and this DVD.
I just hate to wrap up. I feel like I could talk another hour about how lucky we were, how just the stars were aligned. Like if Rick had never met my mom my mom was selling roses. If Rick had never came along, then we'd have never moved to Seymour, and I'd have never met any of these people. None of this stuff would have ever happened if you hadn't moved here.
Same thing could have happened because my mom had custody. I mean, I was living in Maryville. And my dad actually fought for me, and he got me, and I moved to Seymour with him.
See, that could have never happened. We wouldn't even be sitting here now. What would I have been doing last fall? It's funny. If Justin would have never moved here from North Carolina, or Nick would have never moved here from the part of Knoxville he was in, like just amazing to think about.
Another quote is, you know, everything happens for a reason. Everything did happen. And
people came in and out of our lives, and we get frustrated.
Another line from Stand By Me, like people, like friends come in and out of your lives, like trains in a subway depot. That's the truth. They come in and out, and sometimes you blink and they're gone.
If me of all people if I said I didn't believe in fate, I'd be a complete idiot because my life has been complete fate. We'll talk about somebody, and there they'll be, and we'll see them 5 minutes later. We'll lose one friend and gain another one, or just people come in and out the way. You can just tell God has got a plan for us, and He's put these people. He takes them in and out, and from 93 to 2013, these last 20 years of the gang and just life in general has been overall. It's just. I can't even think of the words to even say to describe. To have to sum up the last 20 years is very difficult to do on the spot.
Yeah. But don't mean to belabor things or everything. Keep it going too long. So we've said all. I think we've covered everything from the past 20 years that we can see to cover right now.
I'm still trying to think of a good sign off. It's so difficult. We've spent so much time on this. Our life, our 20 years of memories have led up to us signing off right here, and I don't know how to end this thing. Yeah.
Because whenever y'all see this will be after the wedding, and you probably will not like most of you will probably not be seeing us again after this.
Just basically,
everybody be going on with their lives, so we're trying to think of a good way to
once again, we're glad to have met you all. Glad you all were putting our lives. It's aggravating knowing that we didn't get to spend more time with each other these last few years. Yeah. It's very aggravating.
Yeah, especially we were tied up in the wrestling bullshit during our 20s, and then everybody else had their own lives. So we wish we had more time with you all. But
we were blessed, and these last 20 years have been awesome, epic, and we always have pictures to look back on, memories, and we'll be talking about our parties. We'll be talking about all this stuff. We'll be telling our grandkids about this stuff. So
we're gonna be showing our grandkids this DVD.
Yeah, and I hope you all enjoyed this. I hope you all understand the impact.
I hope we all didn't get too bored, but there's so much stuff we had to cover and everything. I hope you all were able to stick with us and are still here with us right now. Here at the end, because we didn't want to leave anybody out. We didn't want to leave any detail out. We want to make sure all the major stuff was pretty much covered. So,
and with that said,
I think it's time to hit the music, and we're gone.
Gonna make it bend and break. Say a prayer, but let the good times roll. In case God doesn't show. And I want these words to make things right, but it's the wrongs that make the words come to life. But who does he think he is? If that's the worst you got, better put your fingers back to the keys. To the future, but my eyesight is going.